Hi, I'm Keith Ferrazzi. I'm the author of Never Eat Alone and Who's Got Your Back? I think a lot of people use technology to hide. Mm-hmm. And the key is, how do we use technology more effectively to deepen relationships but yet broaden them? I mean, there's a real blessing with modern day technology that allows us to reach out to individuals we would have never been able to find before. And actually have small, intimate connections with people that we'd never be able to get access to. But if you work hard online, you can begin to open the funnel of those relationships, and then through increasing acts of generosity and increasing acts of connectedness and authenticity, you can get to the stage where you can actually start meeting people and developing real relationships and friendships. Well, I mean, there's nothing wrong with a connection that starts digitally. The question is, what's the intention? Is the intention for learning? It's wonderful to be able to follow somebody on Twitter, move to their blog, engage with them, comment on their blog, engage and create a wonderful relationship. When I was in my teens, we used to have this thing called a telephone. You'd actually pick up and put your ear. And I would sit and have very long conversations with very dear friends on the telephone. That was a digital connection. I don't see any reason why we should degrade technology. The question is, what's the intention of the relationship? Is it authentic? Is it generous? That's what matters. Well, that's the tougher piece, because what you got to do is you got to fight that natural reptilian brain desire to fake it, or to fight that natural reptilian brain desire to push people away. It's dangerous. The answer is, you need to let your guard down. You need to be vulnerable. The courage that it takes to be vulnerable is something that is critical in authenticity. My real life superhero. I probably would say, anyone who's a great parent and puts the time to it, particularly people who are doing it at a disadvantage economically, or individuals who may be single parents, economically disadvantaged, and they're still busting their ass to raise a great child. That's a superhero to me. My real life superpower, probably, look, I've always been blessed by caring deeply about the people I'm speaking to. And when I do that, particularly from stage, I have the ability to influence. I have the ability to get people to lean in and to listen. And mostly it's because I start off by not worrying about what people are thinking about me, but I worry about how I can serve them. Well, I've always been fairly natural on stage, talking to folks. So I think that that was a superpower in that regard, and that it happened naturally. But absolutely, I mean, I've worked to refine it. I mean, I grew up a fairly insecure young man, as probably most people do, but mine was economically disadvantaged and going to rich schools at the same time of not being able to afford the same clothes and shoes, etc. When you're constantly thinking you don't deserve to be in the room, it's difficult to be focused on being of service to others instead of, what are they thinking of me? So it just takes a while, it takes practice, and I think everybody can get better. Look, I think it's really important to identify our limiting character aspects on a daily basis. What is it that stops us from being of service to others? What is it that stops us from even serving our greater selves? And if we identify those and we constantly share those with the people around us who love us and care for us, and ask them to hold us accountable when they see them present, I think it's important, because with a small group of people, you can break through the glass ceilings that hold us back. So I think it's an issue of personal diagnosis. It's an issue of working hard with the people around me to be transparent. And then I would say finding enough time to be in contemplation with some form of a higher power. Some people, it's God, it's spirituality, it's whatever it is. But it's so critical to find a peace and to be able to talk to something greater than ourselves. For being the one person that never passed away, it's just, no. I think probably the best way to be remembered is just the impact. You know, I mean, my father, when he passed away a year before it, we had a roast for him. And I invited everybody he knew. I invited all of his friends, his childhood buddies, and all family, etc. And I said, listen, Pops doesn't have too much longer. What you would say at his funeral, I want you to say it now. And I just want you to tell about, you know, how grateful you were for his life and all the things that he did. And we were able to give that to him. And so I think it's so important that we don't choke back those loving, warm compliments about what people really are to us. and that I hope I'll be present at my eulogy a year before and hearing about what kind of an impact I made. Yeah, one thing I do care deeply about is foster care. It's kind of a longer story, but 80% of the U.S. prison population came from foster care. A lot of my work is in the area of relationships and deepening relationships in service of sales, in service of leadership, in service of collaborative productivity within teams. But these kids who have been relationally abused at a very young age and then treated transactionally in the foster care system never learned to trust. And as a result, they find their family in gangs, they find intimacy in prostitution, and they end up homeless and they end up in prison. So it's a broken system, and it's one of my big passions. I've got two foster kids of my own, and I really want to make a difference. I'm working right now with Governor Hickenlooper in Colorado to pilot a program there that we also piloted out here in Los Angeles. So hopefully that'll be something that I make a mark on.